So we would start our course, preferred practice guidelines in cornea, and first the one on glaucoma and on cataract was a huge success, and glaucoma was so crazy packed, like the exactly 6 minutes would get over, there were good amount of discussion, and we look forward to that kind of learning in this particular session with a great set of expert panel and speakers. Our expert panel are Dr. Jeevan Thithiyal, Dr. Namrata Sharma, Dr. Fogla, Dr. Praveen Krishna, and Dr. Revati and Dr. Radhika. And thank you one and all for being here. We start with our first speaker, Dr. Nikhil Gokhale, immensely popular and versatile cornea surgeon and a cataract surgeon, and with the years of practice from Gokhale Eye Hospital, and he's going to talk on diagnosing and managing atypical microbial keratitis, preferred practice guidelines. You can start.
Thank you, and thanks for the opportunity, Chitra. So basically, what's atypical is when we have unusual organisms, often missed on routine microbiology, and often organisms which require very specific antimicrobial therapy. Many of these happen after injuries, after ocular surgeries, or in patients with ocular surface disease. These are very often recalcitrant and indolent ulcers which don't respond to our standard lines of treatment, and they need a high index of clinical suspicion. What typically happens is a diagnostic delay, a treatment delay, and therefore worse outcomes. Some of these atypical infections could be acid fast, could be Pythium infections, parasitic infections, microsporidial infections, and then we have so many unusual isolates of bacteria and fungi. Why do we end up with delayed diagnosis? Sometimes special microbiology techniques, they are not done. Sometimes it's the lack of awareness, a lack of communication between the microbiologist and the ophthalmologist. It could also be a lack of expertise, either on our side or on the side of the microbiologist. And sometimes it's because of lack of access to equipment such as a confocal or molecular biology techniques. So typically, we depend on these first three lines of diagnosis for most of our corneal infection patients. However, when we have atypical infections, we might and we may require the use of molecular biology, confocal imaging, and histopathology as well. So just go through a few images. We know the nocardia infections look like pinpoint infiltrates. They can look like a fungal abscess, and they can also come postoperatively. And these patients are typically treated with amikacin and fluoroquinolone. However, deep-seated infections usually require surgery. Atypical mycobacterial infections come post-surgical. They can also come post-trauma or following steroid therapy. These are again indolent, often with a cracked windshield appearance or with satellite lesions, and they respond to amikacin and clarithromycin, so advanced cases requiring surgery again. Pythium keratitis, something which mimics like a fungus, can come with contact lens or with trauma with contaminated material. The typical features that one needs to look are tentacle-like infiltrates, reticular pattern, guttering. Some of these things in a fungal ulcer should make you suspect it, especially if the ulcer is not responding to routine antifungal therapy. Microbiology, the smears can show ribbon-like folds in the hyphae, which are sparsely septate. However, for confirmation, you need to send them to a higher institutional setup where they can look at zoospore and PCR sequencing. The treatment typically today is with linezolid and azithromycin because it does not respond to the routine antifungals lacking ergosterol. And of course, surgery augmented with alcohol application and cryotherapy may be a way to go for advanced cases. This was a picture sent to me by my microbiologist, and I put it on the Bugbusters to know that and confirm that this looked more like Pythium. And I think this educated my microbiologist, and we treated the patient early. And so this picture saved the patient's eye with early treatment. Microsporidial keratitis typically comes in monsoons, is self-limiting as long as you don't use steroids. However, when you have more advanced cases, or if you have stromal keratitis, we know there is no specific treatment in these cases, and they end up and require a corneal transplant. However, the results of transplants are pretty good if you have excised the entire lesion, and you, of course, may require to do a histopathology in these cases. Acanthamoeba keratitis, we all know in the early stage, looks something like a viral disease. However, the radial neuritis is a very specific factor which can help us to pick up acanthamoeba early. However, once it progresses, you get ring infiltrates and very severe disease, which is very difficult to treat. In India, we see a lot of non-contact lens acanthamoeba infections, and PHMB and chlorhexidine are the main line of management in these cases. Again, to stress, confocal microscopy has a very important role in these cases. And the rare organisms in microbial keratitis, these names you could go on, and there are endless reports which you might find in your day-to-day practice. So in conclusion, if you have an atypical presentation, microbiology is not helping you, the patient is not responding, suspect atypical infection, you have to switch to advanced microbiology technique, diagnose and manage these cases. Thank you.
What would be your tip to differentiate a Pythium from fungal? Did you say that already? I missed it.
Right. So basically, if you send a smear, the microbiologist will say it's sparsely septate. So that is the first thing that I think a general ophthalmologist or the microbiologist can give you a signal that this is Pythium. And then you need to look at there is no response to all the antifungals that you try, and the patient is slowly getting worse. I think you should suspect Pythium and then try to look for the very specific factors which people have described. And then switch your treatment or send the patient to a higher center, because otherwise they're going to lose the eye 100%.
Thank you. Radhika, you would have any question to ask? And I'll be just gone for 10 minutes and I'll be back, and Radhika and Anaga will hold fort. And thank you.
We could never do what you're doing, but we'll try our little bit.
No, you have to do better than me, but keep, none of the audience should become less, it should get added.
Our safety is at stake. We can't let you do that. So thank you, Dr. Nikhil, for that lovely presentation. So I want to ask Dr. Revati on the panel that some of the unusual infections that Dr. Nikhil mentioned, as an institute practitioner, we resort to molecular techniques. So what would be your threshold to do PCR in a corneal ulcer? And what recommendation would you have for a practitioner who's on his own, who may not have access to those techniques? Not just Pythium, madam. Generally, in a case of infective keratitis, when would you recommend doing PCR?
If we are not able to get enough material, if it is too deep, immediately we'll go for confocal. And for other investigations, like PCR and other things, like whenever we don't get what we are expecting to get from the culture, or when we are in doubt, of course, or if there is no response to the treatment as we expect, we'll switch over to those investigations, not as a routine.
So next we have Dr. Vanti, who doesn't need any much introduction. So I welcome her to give her a talk on a very favorite subject of mine, which is the management of viral keratitis.
Thank you, Dr. Radhika. And I thank the ARC committee for the opportunity to be part of this wonderful session. No financial interest to declare. I would be tailoring my talk in the next 6 minutes dot on to what is the preferred practice guidelines of viral keratitis, which we follow according to our Indian practice, or what most of Indian cornea specialists, or how they look at their practice guidelines in managing viral keratitis. So the particular concerns in managing viral keratitis, I mean, all know it's largely a clinical diagnosis here. So the problem comes when we have masquerades, or when there are other conditions which are going to be mimicking viral keratitis. So that's the top concern for people who are managing viral keratitis in their practice. Again, disease modifiers, meaning the virulence of the virus which is causing the infection on the ocular surface and the cornea, and the host immune status are going to be largely responsible for the characteristic of the clinical presentation in a particular case here. So that might vary and give you a different or a varied clinical presentation for a particular organism in a particular patient here. The choice of the topical antiviral and the oral antiviral, the duration of the therapy, and for how long you're going to give it, so that's going to be changing in practice perspectives of each and every corneal physician, the duration of the therapy, and one other concern is how we would address the role of ulcer debridement in management of viral keratitis here. So there was one very recent study which was published in the IJO, which talked about the deviations of practice patterns of Indian ophthalmologists. And though the response rate for this particular study was low, it did give a comparative evaluation of how Indian corneal specialists tackle their viral keratitis with response to or in contrast to the recommendations of the head studies. So the particular features which were varying is about the use of oral antivirals in management of herpetic keratitis here, and how they go about the duration and tapering the medications which they use. So commonly many of them do agree upon the slow taper of topical steroids for viral keratitis, but the route of administration of the antiviral, whether it's topical alone or in combination with oral antivirals here, and the duration of the antiviral prophylaxis were the two particular characteristics which varied when you looked at people's practice patterns here. Again, the availability of the various antiviral agents, the socioeconomic conditions here, the personal preferences, all do play a particular role in the choice or how the practice pattern is guided in these conditions here. The HEADS provides a lot of guidelines and how you would want to tackle. So in the interest of time, I'm not probably going into the details and just narrate what are the key factors in this. So topical steroids improve the clinical prognosis in stromal keratitis without epithelial ulceration here, and they do reduce the time to resolution here. A reduction of 68% is seen in persistent and progressive stromal kerato uveitis patients. Oral antiviral agents, though the study did not give you any statistical significance, but the trend was that it is beneficial to add on oral antivirals in kerato uveitis, but there was no statistical significance. But oral antivirals in the use of, in the presence of iridocyclitis was beneficial here. So that was the recommendations of the HEADS 1. The HEADS 2, when it looked at the role of oral acyclovir in the management of herpetic eye disease and also investigated the risk factors, there was no additional benefit which was found by giving an additional 3 weeks course of oral acyclovir in preventing HSV stromal keratitis or iritis here. But when you looked at recurrence rates, it was able to decrease recurrence rates when you are looking at a stromal keratitis and not at epithelial keratitis. I think most of these are available for you to go through, so we would not look at it in the interest of time, and we will probably look at what is going to be important is the recommend treatment patterns for HSV stromal keratitis without ulceration is topical corticosteroids given over a period of 10 weeks, and it's tapered over about 10 weeks, both topical and oral. If you're preferring a pattern of oral, you can choose. The choice of antiviral will depend upon the economic concerns and the availability to the particular physician and the patient here. And oral antivirals generally do have a better safety pattern. We all know about the various clinical presentations being epithelial, stromal, and endothelial here. So what would you like to give in epithelial keratitis? It's just mostly antivirals here. Withhold your topical steroids, and they ought to be avoided in the presence of epithelial ulcerations here. Oral antivirals do not have a role in just epithelial keratitis, but with stromal involvements, with recurrent stromal keratitis, the role of oral antiviral prophylaxis does play a particular role here and significantly decreases the morbidity of the conditions in the coming years if you give. Again, oral antivirals in the presence of uveitis and endotheliitis is a particular is particularly indicated. Yeah. Just to close with the role of vaccination, again, there is no conclusive evidence that the vaccination is going to be beneficial, but please do be aware of those who are advocating vaccinations, because of course we do not follow much of it in Indian practice, but it can aggravate the morbidity of a disease in terms of the vaccine containing inactivated herpes simplex virus here. Thank you for your patient hearing. I will stop here.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vanathi. It is unfortunate I missed your talk, but I would really want everybody to stick exactly to 6 minutes and conclude so that we have that 2 minutes discussion, and the next person should have their slides ready. We have to do it that way. And
I have a question for Dr. Vanathi.
Yes, yes.
So the eternal question in viral keratitis is that many times we get recurrent cases. So though textbook wise it's elegantly divided into epithelial, stromal, inflammatory, stromal, necrotic and endothelial diseases, we know in common practice that recurrence mars the typical clinical picture. Quite often there is some amount of epithelial SPKs and stromal inflammation, adding to that previous scar and vascularization. So we really don't know, you know, what we are looking at, what layer we are looking at, and we know that the layer decides the treatment. So the question I had for you is that it's largely a clinical diagnosis, HSV. So would recurrences like this be an indication for you to test microbiologically? Or would you still, you know, go by your clinical features when there is a recurrent infection to go ahead with the treatment?
I think when you're talking about recurrent viral keratouveitis, still largely we would depend upon the history, the clinical characteristics which are affecting the ocular surface, the cornea, the thinning associated, and the uveitic pattern, the iritis pattern, which are all going to be, you know, particularly significant markers for saying that these are herpetic. So largely, still we do not go on to look at other microbial diagnosis unless you're having a case of a refractory keratitis, which is probably a complication of a secondary keratitis in these patients.
Okay. No, I haven't reduced it to 5 minutes, 6 minutes only. And I have one very simple question to ask. Maybe I could take it with Dr. Revati. When do you consider PTK for viral SPK scars? How long would you wait for a recurrence-free period?
You mean the post-adenoviral SPK scars?
Yes.
Generally, I never do.
No, any other, wouldn't.
Personally, like I'm against doing any laser treatment in the viral scars.
And what is the thoughts on use of povidone iodine in acute cases? There's any role?
Again, in adenoviral, I think in adenoviral only there is a role for it. Mm-hmm. But usually our patients will not, most of the patients will not tolerate, especially in the presence of an inflamed dye.
Yeah.
Maybe they are trying more diluted forms now, and along with the steroid also, some of them. But we have not tried. We tried for a short time and none of the patients were able to tolerate it.
See, povidone iodine is a contact sterilizer.
Yeah.
It is a disinfectant. So basically, it treats where it touches. There is zero penetration whatsoever. So that has to be kept in context before we try anything with it.
We shall go on to our next speaker, Dr. Soundarya, who is a consultant cataract, cornea, and refractive services at the Eye Foundation Group of hospitals based at Coimbatore. And she is going to talk on the preferred practice guidelines for a stepladder approach to managing dry eye disease.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for the opportunity given. So I'm going to be taking you through the stepladder management of dry eye disease. So due to the limited time given, I'm not going to be going into the diagnostics. So I'll just be talking about the treatment part. So once we diagnose dry eye using the different various questionnaires available, the risk factor analysis, the diagnostic tests like the shimmers, the ocular surface staining scores, and once we subtype the dry eye into evaporative or aqueous deficiency using the mammography, etc. So we're going to target the treatment on three different factors. One is the tear insufficiency, the eyelid abnormalities when present, and the most integral part of dry eye, which is the inflammation. So I'm going to be talking in that way and then finally summarizing the steps. So first is the tear replacement. As we know, the basic treatment in all forms of dry eye is going to be artificial tear substitutes, which have the major component, the demulsins, the low viscosity agents like the carboxymethyl cellulose, HPMCs, and the higher viscosity agents like the HAs and the PEG, PGs, and the dextran and the glycerin. So they have found a meta-analysis, recent meta-analysis has found that HA-containing drugs are more superior to the non-HA ones. And even in the post-phaco dry eye patients, the HA-containing drugs have shown good results. When talking about PEGs, they basically have a longer retention time due to the presence of the HP guar and borate complex. And they also it also allows an epithelial self-repair. And in comparative studies, it has shown to have a better effect when compared with HPMC and CMC drugs. The other components of dry eye, which I won't be going into, the osmoprotectants, the buffers, and the electrolytes. And one of the other important components is the preservatives. And initially, we know that the benzyl conium chloride, which is more epithelio-toxic, and then came the softer preservatives, the sodium chloride, the sodium perborate, polyquat, which disintegrate into inert components. And of course, the most preferred, the preservative-free ones, which are usually reserved for the more severe dry eyes, in which patients are more reliant on a long-term usage of artificial tears. Then coming to the lipid-containing agents, especially in MGD cases where the oil and water emulsions help in longer retention time and the overnight usage of ointments. Next, coming to autologous serum, it has a very similar biochemical characteristics to tears, which are usually used in the 20% formulation. It has anti-inflammatory and reparative properties. Meta-analysis have shown good outcomes when compared with artificial tears at 1 to 3 months in terms of staining, but they didn't show any difference in terms of the shimmers. The major issues in autologous serum are the production, the storage, and the cost issues, and of course the chances of infection. And even in chronic OSD cases, once stopped, the recurrence is common. Mucolytics like acetylcysteine, of course, have been used in filamentary keratitis and in moderate to severe dry eyes. So this was about the tear stimulation. Now coming to the tear conservation, most commonly used approach is the punctal occlusion. It is usually combined with other modalities. We have the punctal intracanalicular occlusion, the complete or partial occlusion, and the temporary or permanent occlusion. So initially, the school of thought was that when there is inflammation, we don't usually use punctal occlusion. But now there have been studies that have shown that even after 3 weeks of occlusion, the inflammatory markers in the tear film did not increase. So it can be used even when there is inflammation along with an anti-inflammatory agent. So other options for tear conservation are the moisture chambers and humidifiers, which are less commonly used. Next, coming to the tear stimulation. So here, this is going to be, we are going to talk about 3% diquefosol tetrasodium, which stimulates both water and mucin secretion. And here, it has shown non-inferior when compared with hyaluronic acid, and the efficacy is also better when combined with the hyaluronic acid. Short-term results have been equivocal, but long-term results have been good. 2% rebamipide, which usually increases mucin secretagogue, increases the number of goblet cells. The action starts at 2 weeks and lasts up to 52 weeks, has shown good results. The more invasive option, the intranasal tear neurostimulator, are usually reserved for very severe cases of Sjögren. Oral secretagogues in Sjögren, pilocarpine, sevimelin, and they've shown that the dry mouth improves much better than the dry eye, so usually not preferred. Management of lid abnormalities. Initially, we start with the lid hygiene and the warm compresses. When talking about warm compress, there's wet and dry compresses. In the wet compress, they've shown that the evaporation is faster, so the cooling down is faster, so may not be as effective as the dry compresses. We have the other commercially available Blepharosteam and the eye bags as well. When talking about the lid hygiene, they've shown that the dedicated lid cleansers are much better than the baby shampoo that we usually prescribe. So usually in both these methods, there is a poor compliance after 6 weeks. So that's when these in-office methods come into play, the lippy flow, which has shown that a single application is usually found to be as good as applying the lid massage and the warm compress for 3 months, and the effect lasts up to 6 months. So we also have the other invasive procedures like the intraductal probing, which is usually not preferred. And of course, treating the corneal exposure is very important. And contact lenses also have been tried, especially in severe cases. But remember, we need to use these for a long term, so the chances of microbial infection are always there. And for higher, more severe cases, the scleral lenses and the Crohn's lenses can also be used because it forms a liquid tear reservoir between the cornea and the contact lenses. Finally, coming to the anti-inflammatory, the topical steroids. Usually in the milder cases, short courses are preferred, and in the more severe cases, a longer course is preferred. And in non-glucocorticoid options, cyclosporine is the most preferred option, which helps in the moderate to severe dry eye, and even in the post-LASIK eyes, it helps. And now it's available as unpreserved single-use applications as well. Tacrolimus is usually reserved for patients who are intolerant to cyclosporine. When talking about biologics, infliximab has been tried, but human studies are quite scarce. And the newer 5% liftagras, which is available in the USA as Xiidra, which is an integrin antagonist, has shown good safety, and it's also been well tolerated and improves the staining score as well. Antibiotics in dry eye, especially in MGD cases, we have the topical and the oral options. Azithromycin has a more anti-inflammatory option as well. But the efficacy of antibiotics over lid hygiene and other treatments, not many studies are available. And also, whether adding a systemic azithromycin to a topical azithromycin has more effect is also questionable. I'm just going to be finishing up. Surgical options like tarsorrhaphy, amniotic membrane grafting for persistent epithelial defects. We also have the Prokera options, which is more easier to use. And salivary gland transplant as a last resort. The only issue is hypoosmolar tears are produced, so corneal epithelial edema is going to be a resultant effect. And this talk won't be complete without environmental modifications. Omega-3 fatty acids in the DREAM study has not shown a better response than placebo. And also the drugs have to be avoided. So finally, summarizing for aqueous deficient dry eye. So first we start with the environmental modifications, add on preserved artificial tears, and then if that's not responding, go on to non-preserved artificial tears or the higher viscosity agents and the overnight applications, temporary punctal plugs, short course of topical steroids, topical secretagogues like rebamipide, and the other cyclosporine options. If that's not responding, then the oral secretagogues in case of Jogren, autologous serum and therapeutic contact lenses. And finally, topical steroids for a longer duration, amniotic membrane grafts in case of PEDs, surgical punctal occlusion or the permanent punctal occlusion, and other surgical options like tarsorrhaphy or salivary gland transplantation. The only additional thing in evaporative dry eye would be we start with the lid hygiene and the warm compresses. Then we go on to the in-office treatments like the LipiFlow and adding up the oral and topical antibiotics. And finally, surgery for the lid abnormalities. Thank you.
Thank you very much for catching a super fast train, but I think the message got conveyed. So Radhika, you take the first question.
So actually, that was a very lovely talk, Soundarya. Yeah. From end to end, you covered everything, you blink and miss kind of situation, but I think there was nothing in dry eye that you left untouched. Yeah. So congrats on that. So I have a question for Dr. Himanshu, actually. Even though you're not on the panel, you probably would be the right person to answer this. Like Soundarya pointed out, for a general cornea person like me, dry eye essentially means looking at whether it's dryness or not, is there any asthenopia or any allergy, and then looking at whether it is aqueous deficiency or it is a lid margin abnormality or a secretorial disease, treat accordingly. The maximum referral I would do is to a rheumatologist if I find an immune component. But then now you have dry eye suites, and tear tests springing up everywhere. And these basically assess the stability of the tear film. The lipid component or the meibomian environment is what is addressed in all these investigations. So could you put it in context? Because you've been through the era where these were not there and you have access to these also. So what is the threshold at which we will refer a patient to these, or should we, you know, stick to the way we were dealing with it earlier if we are happy with the results? You
There's
could do that and come on the podium and talk, because you would be speaking next as well. We have Shreyas coming in
I
later.
I'd be obliged if Dr. Praveen Krishna, Dr. Rajesh and Nikhil come to the panel area.
So if you can answer that from the podium,
because
and
the
then
mics
continue
are there.
Talk.
I want two more floating mics in the first row, please.
Thank you, Dr. Radhika. So basically, the answer is that whenever I see a patient where I'm trying to diagnose it as an evaporative dry eye, I would be very interested to know whether is there a blockage of those meibomian glands. Will my treatment of expiration, whether it's manual or mechanical expiration, would work? And if I do not have an imaging capability to see that, I think it would be unfortunate to then treat somebody who has lost all the glands. Treating them with any form, whether it's a manual or a mechanical expiration, would be useless. Now, whether do we need to refer the patient for those diagnostics? I really don't think that's right. Because I had been doing meibography for ages before even these things started, using my autorefractometer. So any IR devices which gives us image of those meibomian gland should be good enough. So when I diagnose somebody as an evaporative dry eye, least I would like to do is know the morphology of those glands and then try to go ahead with my treatment. Going for the other further treatment, do we need to send all the patient? Would not be the right way to convey to everybody, but when somebody is refractory to normal treatment, would certainly want them to go next step.
But at which point of time would you think you need to investigate more? Like it could. When would you think for Jogren's and any of those things for the younger audience? I would want you to answer.
So, on day one, I would know that where I stand by, unless I take the complete history, complete examination, then we start with the treatment. I really don't think dry eye can be classified in any case as one particular disease. It's not one disease. We forcibly are putting all those diseases together in one kitty. So when we see that the things which you want to investigate, I don't need to wait for future. So possibly on day one, a younger patient who has hypothyroid, who has other immune disorder, I don't need to wait for anything. Yes. I would rather send them on that day only. But same time, when I'm treating any MGD patient and if I feel that my regular treatment is working, I might give them a try. If it doesn't work out, then I'll go next step and
just
further.
Just a small question. Yeah. In case of MGD, if you have given a treatment of IPL or LipiFlow, what would be the test that you would do in the follow-up, and at what point of time? And when do you think the treatment would be actually complete?
Yeah, so
both subjective as well as objective.
Yeah, currently I really don't think anybody has idea. In fact, I was a non-believer thinking that it cannot work in such kind of thing. But having said that, after doing those cases, you realize that many of those patients, if not all, they do well. Now, when we say they do well, it means we are talking about subjective and objective assessment. So whatever you have done preoperatively, you have to do those things postoperatively also, whether your surface staining, whether your BUT, whether your Schirmer, whether your grading system, whatever you're using, your questionnaires, you have to do all those things again. Then only you can claim whether something is working or not working.
So we are also doing that. We find that the scoring system is improved, but it actually doesn't so much reflect on the mimeography or even T, but in all the cases. So if the patient asks, prove to me that you know it's working, whether I mean they may have anywhere from say 10% to 90% improvement subjectively, but how can you prove it?
If I am able to prove, probably I would not be sitting here. I would be sitting somewhere with my big mansion somewhere.
So we go on to Dr. Himanshu's talk now, and he's a medical superintendent and heads of.
Because in my experience, I have self also tried, and I told my patients to try both. I feel bed fermentation is better.
So that was just one of the studies that was shown. So
they said
the evaporation.
Dr. Praveen, you want to say something? No, she said.
She wants to know how do you do dry? I mean, how do you tell the patient?
They have these chambers that provide the dry the temperature increase and heat. So that's what was given in the study.
You take a towel and they have the iron with which you iron clothes. They can apply the towel to that, and then they can apply to the iron.
Basically, it's a simple thing. It's not about wet or dry. It's about latent heat. When you have wet thing, the latency of the heat works better. It stays hot for longer. But when we are talking about machines which are delivering dry heat, they'll always claim about the effectiveness of that particular way. So I really don't think it's going to make huge difference whether you're doing manually. I think it's more to do with the technique of machines when they're comparing those things.
So we go on to, I think we'll take the discussion later. Dr. Himanshu, a medical superintendent heading cornea, refractive and ocular surfaces, and a very dynamic surgeon, and he's going to tell us something very relevant in our day-to-day life. What's new in the management of pterygium? Preferred practice guidelines.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Chitra gave me this topic and I was clueless what's new in pterygium and then preferred practice guidelines. So I conveniently put and in between. So what's new in pterygium and preferred practice guideline. So pardon me for that.
There are a lot of things which are new. In fact, there are a lot of publications which have come in last 5 years about pterygium, and that's very fascinating when I was looking at this thing. Most important part, let's start with grading. Grading system wise, earlier we graded pterygium by one parameter or so. Now there's quite interesting study by SNS in which grades pterygium by different parameters, almost 8 parameters, 4 from cornea, 4 from conjunctiva, which certainly can be more intuitive that it would work better in terms of outcome as well as in terms of diagnosis and deciding treatment. So rather than going by how much the diameter in the cornea, this can possibly work. Next is diagnostic or imaging. Now, imaging of pterygium, well, it's not that intuitive. Why do we need to do that? One interesting study which I came across that using the OCT, you can classify pterygium based on whether it's nodular or whether it's continuous. By continuous, what they meant was that the posterior surface of the pterygium shows a creeping kind of thing, and they found that these pterygium induce more amount of astigmatism, and hence you might want to treat them early rather than late. Or during the cataract surgery, if you see such kind of pattern, you rather want to treat pterygium even though it's smaller and compared to a nodular one. Surgical technique wise, we know that standard of care is by the conjunctival or conjunctival limbal autograft with or without MMC. But interesting thing is our use of anesthesia. Topical anesthesia has been used in pterygium by different people. But interestingly, that it's more of a mental block where we end up giving a local anesthesia, and topical anesthesia in different form can be certainly used with the pterygium surgery. However, it's an individual choice. Second is the graft fixation method in terms of surgery. The graft fixation can be done using glue. Different fibrin glues are available, or autologous blood can be used, or sutures can be used. In fact, something which is new, I'll talk about that. When we talk about glue, there is meta-analysis of American Academy, or rather Cochrane Review, which showed that the glues can have better outcome compared to the suture. One intuitive thing could be the suture can lead to inflammation, and whereas glue does not. But again, overall, whatever works in your hand is fine. But glue certainly is there to stay. One more study from American Academy showed that any type of glue, whatever you use, can actually be fine. So different types of glue, different company of glue can work. Having said that, let me have disclaimer that when we talk about standard companies versus some companies which may not have the quality control, cannot be compared here. But ultimately, whatever works in your hand is fine. So it's not one a specific company is best. Same way, when we compare about glue and autologous blood can work, and it works wonderfully well. The only thing is you have to wait longer, surgical time increases, and sometime overall numbers, if you see, the graft dislocation rate can be, or graft retraction rate can be a little more with that. One more interesting technique which I found was using the electrocautery, whether it's bipolar or monopolar, you can fixate the graft with cautery, and it was found that whether it's a subjective part of it, or whether recurrence part of it, or patient comfort part of it, cautery fared quite well, in fact, better than the most of the other techniques. So saving the money on the glue part, a cautery fixation may not be a bad idea, and certainly something which we must explore. Use of acylity for pterygium has been there, especially larger pterygiums, and especially pterygiums which are including larger part of the limbal area, slit works. It has also been studied in regular pterygium, though there are some contradictory reports about the effectiveness. I would say at this point of time, let's leave slit for the larger pterygiums, those which involve larger amount of limbal tissue. Coming to the adjuvants. Well, one interesting thing which I found was bevacizumab along with the ligation. Now, ligation of pterygium was something very interesting. Using 80 silk, you pass the silk suture under the head of the pterygium and ligate it, and along with an injection of bevacizumab, and they found that within no time, the pterygium regressed, and it was much comfortable. Having said that, the pterygium important part is cosmetic correction, and if we do not take care of the cosmetic part of it, I really don't think that's as great. Similarly, the newer drugs wise, there are studies which are XYO as well as the lab studies which showed that cyclosporin can have a very good outcome on the fibroblast as well as the pterygium tissue, and cyclosporin can be considered. Similarly, there was a study on doxycycline, again lab study, bench study, that the doxycycline can have a very good effect on the pterygium tissue, and this is something which we can surely consider in future. Post-op complication wise, couple of interesting cases I found out where patients had end up getting TAS, toxic anti-assignment syndrome, with pterygium surgery. One was due to povidone-iodine, then second was due to glutaraldehyde or formaldehyde, which they use for cleaning the instrument. So let's keep in mind that part. Finally, the preferred practice pattern showed that anything Bayer sclera, though there are surgical outcome and studies out there which have claimed that Bayer sclera still works, but I think we should understand adjuvant as conjunctival autograft or conjunctival limbal autograft with or without MMC is here, and that's the standard of care for us. So no Bayer sclera, AMT alone is not something which I would prefer. And similarly, intraoperative mitomycin C, there are reports where many people have used in all the cases, but if not, at least in those cases which are recurrent. Thank you very much. To conclude, that newer classification of grading system, ASOCT can be used. Primary and recurrent pterygium can be treated with the topical anesthesia. And adjuvant like CLAG, CAG are primarily
we'll
required.
We'll come
Thank
now
you.
In 2-3 minutes, 5 minutes. Just one question I have. What is the ideal time for your keratometry to stabilize before you can advise a cataract surgery for these patients?
I think it also depends on how advanced the pterygium was. According to the literature earlier, that if the pterygium is very small, less than 2 millimeter, probably a month or half can be fine. Anything more than that, you may have 3 months. What I follow is 2 stable topography, which are done 6 weeks apart. I would consider it as a stable then.
One more question. If there is significant corneal opacity and irregular astigmatism after pterygium removal, what will you do?
If it's affecting my either my refraction or if it's cataract surgery, my keratometry, I would rather treat that thing based on what level it is. If it is on surface, I can peel it off. If it's on the stroma, maybe I can do a PTK.
Okay.
So if it's just the scar that precedes a normal primary pterygium, we find that the burr also works very well.
Sure,
so
she said post-operatively if you find that.
No, that's what I'm saying, intraoperatively. If it's just a primary pterygium and you have those case dots or
yeah.
whatever the little
sure.
bit scar ahead, the burr also works very well. Seems
yeah.
to be a very simple instrument, but post-operatively
yeah.
you do find that the haze is very less.
True.
Thanks a lot, Dr. Himanshu. I think it is Dr. Shirish Kumar who can set up next while we have a quick question for one of the panelists. Maybe Rishi or Dr. Nikhil can answer this. A lot of studies have reported outcomes and drops and special techniques and extended dissection for removal of the pterygium. But there is very little much in place for how you will treat the donor site. So we tried to accumulate 100 patients where we found that when we remove the donor tissue, the conjunctiva, if we leave behind the tenons intact without creating any buttonhole, there is no need to close whatsoever because it acts like a basement membrane and the conjunctiva just covers it. Rather, when we actually try to close it, there is double breasting of the layers. One layer has been removed and one layer is still fully intact, and that actually produces a scar. And we've been able to show that with ASOCT and with clinical assessment that the mobility just becomes like the healing of a corneal defect. So what are your thoughts on that? Would you like to close the donor site, or if it is an uncomplicated, unperforated tenons, would you like to just leave it alone?
Hello, ma'am. So I have never left it open. So
I've always left
yeah.
it open.
In fact, I have left it open in the past, and I've had pyogenic granulomas. So once bitten, twice shy. I always close it, and I don't really get too much of scarring at the donor site. Basically, if you don't take out too much donor material, it won't really cause too much of a problem. So what I do is I don't excise too much of epithelium from the pterygium. Just the unhealthy part at the head, so the defect is actually not very big from my
case. So
cases.
You incise the conjunctiva on
yes,
top
and
you
I
don't actually it. Make a breadthwise excision.
No, no. So because of that, I don't need so much tissue.
Okay. So,
Dr.
you want to add something?
I just want to make one point that the idea about that covering or rather reducing the donor site is not that it's not going to heal. But what happens, the healing does not occur from conjunctival site. The healing always occurs from the limbal site. It's the limbal epithelium which grows over the bare conjunctival defect. In fact, it has been reported and it's been published also. In fact, Sayan has published one paper on healing pattern of conjunctival limbal autograft or how does it heal. And it so larger defect, you need a larger amount of these cells to migrate there. Smaller defect heals much faster that way.
Yeah, but 100 consecutive cases, we found that if the tenons is perforated, then you get infection or pyogenic granuloma and scarring and all those complications. But then the tenons just works like a basement membrane, and the conjunctiva just from either side, from the fornicial side or from the limbal side, we'll leave that open to debate. But it covers it, and the mobility, it's akin to the covering of a corneal epithelial defect, and it's just as mobile both clinically as well as on ASOCT, but that's a personal observation.
Yeah, my opinion also, even you can do the glaucoma surgeries also.
Exactly.
Like
people keep quoting filtration
yeah.
surgery as an indication to close, but I personally feel that filtration surgery is best done over a naturally healed conjunctiva,
mm-hmm.
but then each person may have their own point of view. Thanks, Dr. Repti. So now we invite Dr. Shirish Kumar for this presentation on DALC, and he's going to share with us his tips of the procedure.
Good afternoon. Thank you, ERC team, for the opportunity. So my talk is DALK, tips and tricks to obtain a big bubble consistently, preferred practice guidelines. So we all know the surgical technique for keratoconus has improved significantly with the advances in surgical management and diagnostic evaluation. DALK is considered as the preferred surgical procedure for most of the stages of keratoconus, and it has totally replaced penetrating keratoplasty. And there are various surgical techniques for stromal separation, and big bubble technique described by Anwar and Teekman is the commonly used safest technique to reach the decimates. But of course, big bubble technique, you may not be able to predict the big bubble formation in all the cases. Even in the hands of expert surgeons, you may not predict in all the cases. So it advocates a need for objective factors to predict a type 1 big bubble occurrence. And when you are injecting air bubble into the stroma, you may get three types of bubbles, type 1 bubble, type 2, and type 3. Type 1 bubble is a round margin, is a thick margin, white margin bubble, which is the strongest bubble. And you prefer to have this kind of bubble in all your cases, but it may not happen in all the cases. And this is a type 2 bubble. It's a thin-walled bubble, and it tends to rupture. And you have a clear margin. So it's a large bubble, and invariably this kind of bubbles you get in scarred corneas, and this is the type 3 bubble, which is a mixture of type 1 and type 2. And you can have a larger type 1 bubble and a smaller type 2 bubble, or the reverse. And preoperative evaluation of these keratoconus patients is very important. You have to grade them based on the OCT classification, which is described by Sandali et al. And that classifies the keratoconus cornea into 5 stages, from stage 1 to stage 5. And the first 3 stages of keratoconus, there's no posterior scarring. So these are the cases wherein you can expect a big bubble type 1. And beyond that, 3B onwards, you can expect a type 2 or type 3 bubble. So why this classification is important is you can plan your surgical technique, and you can plan your surgical timing. So if you wait for the posterior scarring to happen, you end up having a type 2 bubble, and type 2 bubble, the chances of perforation is very high. So up to 3A, you can safely go ahead and do a type, that is a big bubble technique. And beyond that, it is the other techniques. It's better to follow either a manual dissection or a visco dissection or saline dissection described by various authors. This is a typical big bubble formation. This is a type 1 big bubble, which has a white margin. It's a thick margin, and it usually will be around 8.5 millimeters, and it's a strong bubble. You can end up having a DALK in all the cases of type 1 bubble, and this is again a case of type 1 bubble. You can even inject a air bubble into the anterior chamber, so that will give us a clue that the bubble is forming. It displaces the bubble to the periphery in the anterior chamber. So you can safely go ahead and do a big bubble technique in these cases. And my technique is I usually do a big bubble technique in most of the cases, and I just rupture the bubble and then inject viscoelastic substance to the neck incision, and with the help of a venous scissor, divide the posterior segment into 4 quadrants, or sometimes 5-6 segments. The dissection can go up to the margin of transfination margin, and then prepare the donor button. You just peel off the desmoid endothelial complex using a Wexel sponge, and give a thorough irrigation to the host, and then place the graft and suture it. And coming to type 2 bubble, which can happen in scarred corneas, you can see here a nice type 2 bubble which is formed here, which has got a thin margin. It's a clear margin, and chances of rupture is very high. A few case examples. This is one case with a deep scar. You can see the OCT of this particular patient. The scar is extending right up to the posterior stroma, and you can expect a type 2 bubble in this particular case. So this is a type 2 bubble formation. You have noticed type 2 bubble formation. So identify this and plan your surgery accordingly. You go ahead and do a manual dissection in these cases. It's better not to rupture the bubble, and indirectly you're going to rupture the Descemet's membrane, which is actually the wall of this bubble is thin. It contains only the Descemet's, which is around 14-15 microns in thickness. And this is the preoperative and postoperative picture of the same patient. And this is a case, it's a very old case of mine, maybe around 10-12 years old. And
excuse me, can you please conclude?
Okay, and this is the Duwa's layer I'm separating. This should not have been done. Like I was over enthusiastic, I just wanted to demonstrate the Duwa's layer here. So far, so good. You have a nice Duwa's layer, and you are left with only the Descemet's here. And I'm just trying to separate it. So the next case, I'm just separating some part of the layer. It gives way. There's a huge rupture. It's extending from limbus to limbus. So it's better not to try this. There is no need to separate these Duwa's. So the occurrence of big bubble 1, there is a paper on this, British Journal of Ophthalmology, factors which influence big bubble formation.
Sorry, sir, we are really running short of time. Can
you bubble, please? Absence of posterior scar on OCT stage 1 to 3A. These are all the cases wherein you can expect a type 1 bubble, and you can plan your surgery accordingly. If it is a big bubble DALC, if it is like up to stage 3A, you can go ahead and do a big bubble DALC. And beyond that, it is a manual dissection. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Shirish. Sorry about that. There was a wealth of material in your presentation, but unfortunately, we're really running short of time. So maybe the audience can catch up with you on a one-to-one basis if they want to ask anything. I request next Dr. Rajesh Fugla, fantastic corneal surgeon and a friend of mine. While he sets up his talk on endothelial keratoplasty, I have a quick question for the panel, Dr. Praveen maybe, on Dr. Shirish's talk. So basically, treatment of keratoconus in the form of surgery started out as epikeratophakia procedures, and then we moved to DALC, basically because we wanted to remove the entire diseased tissue, and the interface becomes more pristine when you do DALC as opposed to an epikeratophakia. And then now we're probably moving back to augmentation procedures where we're retaining the cornea and inserting lenticules to make it stronger. And here I feel the interface becomes double now. So there are two interfaces to deal with. So how would you rate these procedures when you choose one versus the other? Or would you say that the indications are totally different?
I think it's the indications and the surgeon and the patient, all three factors put together. And all procedures are going to remain relevant. If we have a patient who desires extremely good vision and is willing to put in the effort to follow up and ensure that he comes for follow-up, then he probably can go for a procedure like a DALC. If somebody wants a simple procedure and are okay with slightly lesser vision, but also wants a low maintenance eye, then these kind of augmentation procedures probably seem to be good. Similarly for surgeons as well, like DALC, you probably need a lot of training and you have a really long learning curve to be able to become a good DALC surgeon. But augmentation surgeries, again, have like a 10-minute procedure under a laser. Almost anybody could do that if they're familiar with refractive surgery. So I think at the larger community level, the provision of skills to anyone to be able to take care of most patients is also an important consideration, rather than limited to only a few fantastic surgeons like Praveen.
No, I completely agree with what Praveen has said, and it depends on patient requirement and what can be done. Obviously, as clinicians, we would want to offer a surgical procedure that more number of people can perform and not restricted to a few, and they can get identical results. Stromal augmentation is there, but we still have a lot of variables there, which we need to, as we do more number of cases, we may have the answer of what is the right shape of the lenticule that you put in, what depth you put in, and what is the kind of time frame in which you can do additional procedures.
Right. So it's a gamut
that
of indications.
That is where in future maybe
overlap.
A preferred practice pattern on that may give you more answers.
So it's a gamut of indications with a little bit of overlap, but each has a place under the
absolutely.
Sun.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Rajesh. If on that note, you will proceed with your presentation on endothelial keratoplasty.
Thank you, Radhika. And I'll be talking about the preferred practice pattern of endothelial keratoplasty. No financial interest to disclose. Over the past decade, we have seen that the tendency of corneal transplantation, it is shifting from full-thickness penetrating keratoplasty to endothelial keratoplasty, especially DSEC surgery. The advantage of endothelial keratoplasty is that minimally invasive, eliminates the suture-related complications, better refractive outcomes, reduced risk of endothelial rejection. And if what are the different types of procedures? You have the decimate stripping endothelial keratoplasty or DSEC. DSEC, which where you do prepare the tissue using automated microkeratome. You have the ultra-thin DSEC. You have the decimus membrane endothelial keratoplasty and the pre-decimus endothelial keratoplasty. So in literature, you will find all these terms, what I have just mentioned. Among all the procedures, you can see that these are from the iBank Association of America, and you find there is an increasing tendency of surgeons to choose DMEC procedure among the available endothelial keratoplasty. And in the indications, what you see here back in the US, and if we compare with our indications, they are quite similar. Post-cataract surgery, corneal edema, especially pseudophakic bullous keratopathy seems to be the leading indication. The next indication, common indications would be the Fuchs endothelial dystrophy. Besides that, we do perform there for failed penetrating keratoplasty grafts, especially after therapeutic. Rarely we do come across ICE syndrome and CHED where endothelial keratoplasty can be performed. In the pre-op evaluation, yes, it's important to see there's the absence of corneal scarring, because if you have a scarred cornea with irregular astigmatism, putting in an endothelial disc will not result in the patient seeing better. What type of procedure you do depends on the visibility of the anterior chamber details. The corneal dimensions are required to decide the size of the graft that you're going to put in. You also need to take into consideration the anterior chamber volume, especially what's the angle depth that you have. The lens status and stability also helps you choose the type of procedure you perform. The IOP should be under control, and the retinal status evaluation is important in terms of the patient visual outcome. For DSEC, the donor age can vary anywhere between 10 to 80 years. The ideal cell count should be, ideally should be more than 2,400, but I think with the availability that you have, a cutoff of 2,400 is what I use in my clinical practice and do recommend to others. Make sure that if you're preparing your own tissue, there is a 2 millimeter rim available because you need to mount them on an artificial chamber. Tissue can be prepared manually or with the microkeratome. Ideal thickness varies between 150 to 180 microns, and the common diameter that we use in clinical practice is about 8 millimeter. DM stripping in the host, recommendation is make it slightly larger, and that allows better apposition to the stromal tissue and less chance of dislocation, especially in DMEC. Donor insertion for DSEC, the sliding technique is quite popular, does not require any expensive instrumentation, but dedicated inserters like the Bucine Glide or the EndoGlide or the EndoSaver helps reduce the amount of endothelial cell loss. You can use air for tamponade, but 20% SF6 non-expansile is equally safe, and it reduces the risk of donor dislocation, and which is helpful in the starting the learning curve of the surgery. Inferior PI, most of us do perform because with a complete air fill or gas fill, it prevents pupillary block. For DSEC, the corrected visual acuity 20/40 or better is usually achieved in 3 to 6 months. You see a hyperopic shift because of the concave nature of the lenticule that you put in, which makes the posterior cornea more steeper. So the change in refraction is about 1 to 1.5 diopters hyperopia. Endothelial cell loss at 6 months is in the range of 14 to 54%. At 1 year is about 16 to 61%. The cell loss in the immediate post-operative period may be higher than what you see with penetrating keratoplasty, but at 5 year data, comparative data have shown the cell loss is quite similar. Graft survival is good. Donor dislocation rate, again, depends on the experience of the surgeon. The risk of endothelial rejection is definitely lower than what you see with penetrating keratoplasty. Ultra-thin DSEC is similar to DSEC, except that the lenticule is less than 100 microns. Most eye banks in the US do perform prepared tissues thinner than 100 microns, and they have something called the nano thin DSEC as well, where it is thinner than 60 microns. The rest of it remains the same, but insertion is a little tricky because once the donor tissue is thinner, it becomes more floppy, it's less rigid, so it requires a little bit of more expertise to put in the graft. Again, the best corrected visual acuity, a greater percentage achieved 20/20 or better, and the endothelial cell loss is similar, but the endothelial rejection rates are lower than standard DSEC. So ultra-thin DSEC is somewhere between a DSEC and a DMEC, so it takes advantage of the surgical technique of DSEC and the visual outcome and the endothelial rejection rates of DMEC. For DMEC, the donor age usually preferred is between 50 to 80. You don't take younger than 50 because you can have difficulty in handling the donor tissue. The donor is usually prepared with manual stripping. Diameter is about 8 to 9. Stripping is again 1 millimeter larger than the size of the donor tissue. Use 20% SF6 for AFL. Mean visual acuity is better than DSEC or ultra-thin DSEC and about 20-25 by 3 months. Greater percentage achieve 20/20 or better. The hyperopic shift is quite minimal. It's only about 0.5 to 0.75 diopter, and that also because of the resolution of edema. The central edema resolves faster than the periphery, so you can have that. Endothelial cell loss is comparable to what you see with DSEC. The risk of endothelial rejection varies between 1 to 4%. This is, again, comparative data from the American Academy, where all the points that I've mentioned right now, they are covered, that the dislocation rate or the need for rebubbling is more with DMEC. The donor failure in the learning curve is higher with endothelial keratoplasty compared to PKP. The rejection rates are lower with the lowest with DMEC compared to PKP. The best spectacle corrected visual acuity is much better with DMEC. That's why it's being more preferred and a lot of surgeons are moving towards it. The amount of refractive shift is again lower with DMEC, and the endothelial cell loss rates are quite comparable in the long run between all the three procedures. Thank you. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Thanks a lot, Rajesh, for that succinct description. So one quick question to you before Shreya sets up his presentation is that this journey, however elegantly you've described and however appealing it looks when a master surgeon like you does, we know has got its ups and downs. So if there is an erling surgeon who is an individual practice, who does not have much access to expensive courses, how do you suggest that he or she takes this journey with the least amount of training difficulty?
I think as now there are a lot of structured program being available. One of them, I think Praveen and Nidhi Gupta have started on Facebook, which is called the EKLG group, which does a lot of surgeons from worldwide giving all the tips on that. So attending those lectures, going and observing surgeries and then doing a little bit of wet lab practice definitely makes the learning curve much more easier than just starting off on your own and trying to figure out how to transition from DSEC to DMEC.
Thank you very much. So now I invite the young and dynamic Shreyas to take us through his methods of surgically dealing with the various stages of keratoconus.
Thank you so much, madam. And I will try in the next 6 minutes to cover to the extent possible the wide variety of options that nowadays we have, and add to this additive procedures, that's a whole talk in itself. Now so many options coming up. So I will try to cover to the extent possible. This is just a kind of a brief algorithm, I think, which with minor modifications, what most of us follow. The first and foremost thing that I would like to say is before we really, though the talk is on surgical, the first thing that any one of us should do when we see a keratoconic patient is to see if they are contact lens tolerant. Because all said and done, that continues to give the best quality of vision, whether you're using RGP, ROSK, miniscleral, scleral lenses, they continue to have the best quality of vision. And second is to see if the visual axis is clear. If the visual axis is not clear, there is a significant amount of apical scarring, then really there is no point in even cross-linking these patients because they are not going to have any vision after the cross-linking procedure. So these are patients where you could directly subject them to a DALK rather than doing any other procedure. But if the visual axis is clear, please go ahead and of course if the keratoconus is progressive, then go ahead and do a cross-linking. So cross-linking, definitely for older patients, you can easily observe them, wait for progression. Just young patients, pediatric, pre-teens and this thing, there is a very high risk of progression even in a short period of time. So either keep them on very close follow-up or cross-link them at diagnosis for very young children. What type of cross-linking do we use? Conventional can be still used, but only caveat is that it does, in on and off, does produce a greater extent of haze in patients. So most of us have switched over to the accelerated forms. Epi-on versus epi-off, though it was clearly proven that the standard epi-on is really not of much use, but there is renewed interest with the higher concentration riboflavin available, with a higher energy delivery and supplemental oxygen. We have seen that even patients with epi-on can be treated with this higher concentration supplemental oxygen. And they continue to have excellent results and good stability. Customized CXL can also be used, but for lack of time, I'll not go into the details. But yes, it is a viable option for flattening the cone a little more selectively and inducing stiffening. Subsequently, for visual rehabilitation, if it is a well-centered cone, you could consider doing a topo-guided PRK if there is sufficient tissue left. So because topo-guided PRK has a combination of both myopic hyperopic ablation to give rise to a more smoother anterior surface, we generally want to have a minimal thickness of around 400 and 350 at the end of ablation. We try not to ablate more than 50 to 60 microns, reduce the optical zone size to maybe 5.5. Target refraction, again, definitely give some kind of undercorrection, especially if you're doing a conventional cross-linking where you can have a lot of flattening. The goal is really, you should never push the patient into hyperopia. The emphasis is really on regularizing the anterior surface and improving the quality of vision. Centered versus decentered cones, it works a little better with centered cones. Though slightly decentered cones, it can still be done very effectively, but grossly decentered ones, better to stay away. Topographic cylinder would be the way to go rather than doing a subjective refraction, as a repeatable wavefront is a challenge. So these are just some case examples where excellent symmetry has been achieved postoperatively with improvement in UCVA as well as best corrected visual acuity in well-selected cases. If the cone is eccentric, intracorneal ring segment is a very, very useful option. And generally, patients with slightly compromised visual acuity, 6/12 or less, would be good. We look at the location of the cone, and if the cone is well-centered, you can use symmetric ring segments. If the cone is decentered, that is more than 50% is outside the 3mm zone, you can use asymmetric segments. So when we say asymmetric, we have a thinner segment superiorly and thicker segment inferiorly, trying to shift the cone a little more centrally and producing flattening over the apex of the cone, which is essentially what we are trying to do with this. In cases which have a very high ISA symmetry, you can use a single inferior ring segment, so 10 to 12 diopters of ISA symmetry. These patients do very well with a single inferior segment. And patients who have mostly astigmatism, hardly any myopic component or very low hyperopia, you can use the shorter arc segments, like in this example, where you can use just a 90 degree arc segment, which really helps in debulking the cylindrical component and flattening along that axis, rather than causing a global flattening, which can increase the amount of hyperopia that the patient has. Contact lens fitting post intacts can be a little more challenging. So please be sure that the patient is contact lens intolerant, or you can really give a good outcome with intacts. Because following intacts, the same contact lens will not fit. Yes, specialized contact lenses can be done even following intacts, but it is remains a challenge. Post intacts, if there is sufficient tissue left, you can do topo-guided PRK, but the amount of haze is a little bit more, so you would like to avoid it. Toric phakic IOLs, either in stabilized keratoconus with good best spectacle corrected visual acuity, or you improve the quality of vision with the topo-guided PRK or intracorneal ring segments, and then go ahead and improve their best corrected spectacle visual acuity, and then go ahead and do a phakic IOL. I think DALK has already been covered by SK sir in a great detail, but basically in this armamentarium, wherever, like I mentioned, if the visual axis is not clear, very advanced keratoconus or contact lens intolerant, you can go ahead and do a DALK. Now DALK, while big bubble gives a better outcome in the early period, but even if you fail to achieve a big bubble and you have to do a manual DALK, I'm specifically showing this example because of the challenges sometimes which we can face, and then subsequently there's a big bubble is done. But even with a manual DALK, we have seen that we can give good outcomes, and in the years to come, the amount of interface also regularizes. So we have a wide range of treatment options, and with judicious decision making and combination therapy, we can give good outcomes. Thank you.
I would request Dr. Radhika to take the Shreyash spoke comprehensively. Radhika has a question.
Yeah, so thanks for the.
You could connect your.
Thanks for the covering of the topic very nicely, Shreyash. Just like the dry eye talk, I don't think you've left anything untouched. in the treatment of keratoconus. I have a very basic question for you while Dr. Tandon sets up her presentation, that when we do generic CXL, not the customized version, people have mostly given up on using isotonic riboflavin. Many people prefer the HPMC version. While it confers much better safety and security to the cornea and the inner structures of the eye, I personally feel that when you do it for every case when the cornea is thicker, you cross-link very less because you cross-link a swollen cornea. So would you still distinguish between isotonic and HPMC CXL, or would you just do HPMC for every case when there is more than 400 micron thickness?
We have completely switched over to using only HPMC and don't use dextran any longer, madam. But I think there is, yes, I do agree, there is some amount of swelling which happens, but the amount of swelling is not so high even when we do on-table ultrasound measurements, tachymetry measurements, that that it will prevent or preclude us from achieving a good cross-linking
so
procedure.
So you feel that
the amount of not having detergescence is possibly more important.
Right. So you feel that the depth of cross-linking is not very much compromised even if you use HPMC across the board. Thanks a lot, Shreyas. So I invite Dr. Radhika Tandon to talk to us about grading and management of chemical injuries.
Thank you so much. Am I audible? Okay. So I'm going to cover, I have no financial interest, talking about whatever we do, we can look at what is the evidence available in literature. And the basic thing that we're looking at, that chemical burns are vision and eye threatening, there's various phases, and what is a guide for treatment? There's a wide variety of disorders, a wide variety of spectrum of presentation, and also when the patient presents. So when you look at what to do, you have to also take that into account. Now, we also know that so severe ocular injury resulting from chuna packets, as we found, often affects children in North India. I believe in South India, this is not that common. Now, looking at the prognostic value of classification, when you talk about classification, I think it is better to go for the DUAS classification. We can shift over from the previous Roper Hall classification, because in DUAS classification, we are taking into account the entire ocular surface, the conjunctiva as well, and we're further subgrading it for the last 6 hours. So we have just confirmed this by an RCT with 100 patients, looking at the various baseline parameters, looking at the outcome variables, and it was better prognostic value of using the DUA classification in predicting what happened eventually. Regarding the management options, amniotic membrane has been used for a long time, and it has stood the test of time, but there are a few qualifying points that I would like to add for this therapy. We all know the various mechanisms of action, and I will not spend time on that. But you have to remember there are a lot of biological factors and variations which may occur, because even the amniotic membrane is not a standardized membrane. It will depend upon various factors and also the time for intervention. Looking at the level of evidence, and you look at systematic reviews and RCTs, there was a Cochrane review of the amniotic membrane transplant. But remember that even this, you have to look at the time for intervention. So when you're actually looking at the first 7 days and then you look at the results, that's all right. But you may have patients who come later. So therefore, you have to use a judicious kind of approach yourself. And I'll just guide you through that, how one should plan. So we have definitely got many studies from India, including from our center, LB Prasad, and many others, which show that amniotic membrane transplantation in acute chemical burns is useful and should be done. However, if you look at the outcomes depending upon when you intervene, sometimes it may be a question of over-treatment. So if you look at the sub-categorization of patients, and we looked at the ones where actually it was treated within the first 7 days of injury, and looking at in comparison to standard medical therapy, it was found that there was in terms of our paper, which was taken into account in the Cochrane review, it felt that there was no selection bias and allocation concealment was good. However, there was no possibility of blinding, because you definitely know which is the patient who had the amniotic membrane. Similarly, there was a possibility of a detection bias in terms of outcome. So these are the things when you look at purely evidence, it's a mathematical kind of an approach, whereas clinically, we have to use our clinical judgment. So therefore, I would say that you cannot go entirely blindly on evidence-based data. You have to use your own clinical acumen and your judgment in deciding which way to go. So Certainly, one would say moderate and severe burns. If you look at patients of amniotic membrane versus control, the healing of the epithelial defect as well as the sensitivity to pain was very significant in the moderate burns. The very severe burns often have no pain at all because there's a complete deadening of the nerves. But in terms of healing of the epithelial defect, it is faster with the amniotic membrane. Now, looking at another alternative, umbilical cord serum therapy in acute ocular chemical burns. We also compared umbilical cord therapy with amniotic membrane and autologous serum, and umbilical cord serum therapy did have an edge. However, it has disadvantages. It's not easily available, and it's not sort of easily accessible when you want it. But it's a kind of a treatment worth considering in selected cases. So comparing the safety and efficacy of the cord serum versus amniotic membrane, retrospective study of 45 eyes in each group also done from our center. And cord serum therapy was more effective in restoration of ocular surface after acute chemical injuries compared to amniotic membrane or standard therapy. So we have an ongoing project of looking at cultivated oral mucosal epithelial transplant versus amniotic membrane in bilateral acute chemical burns because there's a heterogeneity of disease presentation. There could be variations in timings of presentation and treatment. There could be undefined criteria for treatment success and failure and non-uniform outcome measures. So currently acceptable indications for use of cord serum or amnion therapy would be moderate to severe burns, failure to show healing of the epithelial defect. So when the patient first comes to you, start the standard therapy, reassess in two days. If there is a marked healing, you need not go in for the surgical intervention. But remember that when you have an RCT, we had the control group having very careful care and mechanical release of any simblepharon formation every 2 days, whereas this is not practical in a normal clinical setup. So therefore, if you feel it's not going to be possible to give that much of hand-holding, you can go ahead for the amniotic membrane straight away, also particularly in children, where it's not very easy to take them up for repeated GA. And serum drops with a crossover to application of amnion would be another option and an acceptable treatment therapy. Thank you so much.
That was a very crisp talk. I have one question. I'm not for the expert panel. Mm-hmm. I'm sure some of them like me may want to know. So I'm going to ask Dr. Praveen. Is there a role of allosulate in acute chemical imagery just to stabilize and epithelize the surface?
I think the goal in acute injuries is always to reduce inflammation because whenever you do an allosulate, I think the chances of survival of the transplanted cells go down if inflammation is there. So I think first step is to make sure the surface is stable, reduce inflammation. As a second surgery, it seems to work better than the primary one.
You have a question?
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Radhika, for straddling two halls and completing your talk and giving a very wonderful overview.
Yes.
We just finished on time, so that was a capsule.
Yes.
So since Rishi is already on the podium, let me point my question to him from Dr. Radhika's talk before we continue with your own. I'm no ocular surface surgeon, but what I've taken to doing recently is that we have these keratoplasties that we do in depressed or suppressed limbus. Like, for example, somebody's had a very severe viral keratitis which has healed, or somebody's any other infectious keratitis, in some cases of xeroderma pigmentosa, where you find suppressed limbus. And to get by the immediate post-operative period, what I've started doing is when I'm doing the keratoplasty, I'm taking sled bits from the same fresh donor and putting them under an amniotic membrane. These are cases which will anyway require immunosuppression, so that will help the sled to survive. Even if the sled doesn't survive long term, it acts as a crutch support for the immediate post-operative period and the host will take over. So what do you think about an approach like this?
You're taking the sled from the donor cornea itself.
Yes, while I'm taking the keratoplasty tissue, I'm taking the sled bits from the same cornea. This is when I see 360 degree suppressed limbus, in like in the examples that I gave you.
So I think that's not a bad idea at all, because anyway you have tissue. But otherwise, in general, SLET along with keratoplasty has a lower survival rate. But
so my indications are not strictly acute chemical burns or things like that. It is for me to get by the post-operative period.
Sure.
So the same amniotic membrane
reasonable.
And the immunosuppression may confer benefit to, you know, this. So seems to be working a little well.
Yeah.
So I just wanted your
That's
opinion
a reasonable
on that.
Approach, ma'am.
So we now go on to Dr. Rishi Swaroop, who is the medical director and senior consultant at Swaroop Eye Hospital, Hyderabad. Again, a very versatile surgeon, and he's going to talk on current role of limbal stem cell transplantation preferred practice guidelines.
Thank you, ma'am.
So before Rishi starts, I would like to thank everybody, including Dr. Chitra. So I'm getting late for the next session. So it's been wonderful being in this session, and I learned a lot. Thank you, Dr. Chitra. Thanks, everybody.
Thanks for your superb moderating.
Thank you, Dr. Chitra, for involving me in this preferred practice pattern. Unfortunately, I had a problem with my presentation this morning, so I had to borrow Sayan's presentation just now from trade. And he has almost all the slides are his, and I'd like to just acknowledge that straight away. So, basically, we all know that the limbal stem cells exist in the palisades of Vogt at the limbus, which are these radial brown striae. We've all seen them. And this is basically the seat of the corneal stem cells. Now, limbal stem cell deficiency can have a complete spectrum from partial limbal stem cell deficiency seen in the first picture to the ones at the bottom in which the entire cornea is covered with a pannus. And if you see picture F, you can see these white Trantas dots. So this is a patient with chronic vernal keratoconjunctivitis who also can present with a stem cell deficiency kind of a picture. So in a partial limbal stem cell deficiency like so, you can often have the central visual axis spared, and so the patients might still get away without any surgical intervention, but once the visual axis starts getting involved, then you really need to do something about them. So what are the causes of limbal stem cell deficiency? Most of the time it is unilateral, but sometimes it can be bilateral. Unilateral are almost always because of chemical injuries. Bilateral, in addition to chemical injuries, can be from chronic allergic conjunctivitis like the picture in the previous slide. And then you have conditions like Stevens-Johnson syndrome and congenital aniridia, etc. So what is the algorithm for management of total limbal stem cell deficiency? If it is a unilateral limbal stem cell deficiency in which one eye is completely healthy and one eye has got the pannus on the cornea, and if it's a wet surface, then often these patients benefit from some sort of a autologous limbal stem cell transplantation, whether it's ex vivo or simple limbal epithelial transplantation. If it is a bilateral condition, then you need to have some site of the donor tissue. So if it is a bilateral, whereas one eye has a little bit of tissue, then you can take that, grow it ex vivo in a lab, and then transplanted onto both the eyes. But if the entire thing is completely damaged, then you need some allogenic source of the limbal stem cells, which could be a live-related or a cadaveric donor. And this may or may not be combined with a keratoplasty. And of course, these patients definitely require immunosuppression. The other option is to go for a Boston type 1 keratoprosthesis in these eyes. If the eye is completely dry, bone dry, like in the picture below, then if there is visual potential, then it's worthwhile going for type 2 Boston keratoprosthesis or osteodontokeratoprosthesis, and LVP also has a LVP K-Pro. So one of these could be used. And of course, there's no visual potential, then you can just go for some cosmetic options. If you have a partial limbal stem cell deficiency like this, sometimes you can get away with just doing a conjunctival autograft after just, you know, debriding the pannus from the periphery. And you don't really need to do a transplantation, but nowadays we also add a few of these limbal bits called mini slit, and that works quite well. So this is the same patient after a conjunctival autograft alone, and you can see the patient has done very well. And this is because the rest of the cornea has a good limbal reserve. And from there, the epithelium just kind of comes down and covers up the area which is having a pannus earlier. It's important to make a correct diagnosis of limbal stem cell deficiency because if you miss the diagnosis and go ahead and do some sort of a keratoplasty, that's likely to fail. And if you have wrongly diagnosed it, then you may end up doing a limbal transplantation unnecessarily, and you may compromise the limbus in the fellow eye or wherever you're taking the donor site from. So the LVP group has come out with one of the ways of making a more accurate diagnosis of limbal stem cell deficiency using high resolution OCT and also angio OCT, in which they are able to identify the vascular pattern of the pannus as well as the reflectivity pattern of the epithelium to be able to predict correctly whether this is a stem cell deficiency or not. So which technique of limbal stem cell transplantation or limbal epithelial transplantation should one do? We have basically three options. One is an ex vivo limbal epithelial transplantation, which is what they were doing at LVP for very long. And now they've switched over to simple limbal epithelial transplantation. And I think this is now become the gold standard. Of course, you can also combine it with a conjunctival limbal or a keratolimbal autograft. So earlier when they were doing the ex vivo, the survival was about just short of 70%. That did do well, but not everybody had a good outcome. Then they moved over to from 2010 onwards to simple limbal epithelial transplantation. This was a pioneer work from Dr. Sangwan and his group. And this was inspired by what they were doing similarly for skin grafts. So basically they take limbal tissue from the fellow eye, excise the pannus from the affected eye, and then apply amniotic membrane graft, and on that small bits of these limbal tissue applied and a bandage contact lens applied, and you can see the epithelium starts growing out from these explants and covers the entire surface. So these are the ideal indications. Of course, eye should be wet, underlying stroma should be clear. Can I just take a minute more, ma'am? And of course, it should be unilateral without simblephora. So just show you, I won't show you the surgical video, but you can see in this, we take this little 1 to 2 clock hours of limbal tissue, break it into tiny bits, and after the pannus has been resected, you apply an amniotic membrane has been glued on the surface, you apply these little bits and put a bandage contact lens on top, and you can see how beautifully the cornea clears up within a short period of time. Survival rates are much better, especially in adults, compared to the ex vivo clet. And you can see long-term, even scars can start becoming much lighter, and you end up with wonderful outcomes. A case like this can come to a situation like this. If it's bilateral, if donor limbal tissue is available, like I said, you can do, if no donor limbal tissue is available, go for allo-slit or ex vivo slit. If otherwise, you can also consider Comet or a Boston Type 1 K-Pro. If it's completely dry, we can go for a osteodontokeratoprosthesis or a Type 2. So to summarize, limbal stem cell deficiency is rare but a serious cause of blindness. Diagnosis should be supplemented by objective techniques. Treatment is limbal stem cell transplantation, which has very good success rates now. And you can use any of these techniques, all do work well. SLET, of course, is now very popular because it's really simple. You don't need a lab. And if you apply the technique properly, successful outcomes, very good successful outcomes are possible. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rishi. That was wonderful. Even though borrowed and delivered late, but I'm not happy about it. Not on my videos. You should be well prepared, but it was good.
Thank you.
One question to Dr. Rajesh. Immunosuppression following alloslet, if you're forced to do it, and what would be the duration?
So if you do immunosuppression for alloslet, it will be the same as any allograft procedure, and it does require long-term immunosuppression because all the original limbal transplantation was all the allograft procedures. And we have seen that as long as the immunosuppression is maintained, the surface remains intact. The moment the immunosuppression you discontinue, it tends to get rejected and fails. So immunosuppression is very important. And what we have right now with the use of tacrolimus, we are able to avoid giving too much of systemic.
Yeah. Yes. Even how? I've had a couple of patients on tacrolimus alone, and the ex vivo, the slit has survived. Yeah.
Last question, and you all have to stay for the photograph. How do we, Dr. Radhika, how would you differentiate an allograft rejection to a repeat limbal stem cell deficiency?
The allograft rejection will present like an acute episode. There will be inflammation, whereas if there's a recurrence of a limbal stem cell deficiency, there will not be an inflamed eye. You will have vascularization and growth of the conjunctiva, but it will not be inflamed.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Any question from the audience? I tried my best to cover some simple questions which you all may need. We have to conclude.
Ma'am, I want
louder.
I want to know is there any difference in the chronic stromal keratitis HSV versus the zoster.
Question to be answered.
Usually, zoster does not, you know, when you have a case of HSV keratitis versus zoster, it is not usually very chronic with zoster. Whereas HSV is the one which has multiple recurrences. It's not so common with zoster to have that many recurrences. And with zoster, there'll be the other symptoms, no, that there would have been an unilateral involvement, there would have been skin reaction. So that
yes,
history
if
would
these
be there.
Patients do come with chronic symptoms, stromal keratitis, then what would be my management?
Then you have to treat the recurrences less with oral acyclovir because it is not so much a recurrence of the active viral replication. So you can give topical anti-inflammatory steroids, look for raised intraocular pressure. There may be breakdown of the epithelium. So in usually zoster recurrences are not that common firstly, and if they are, they happen, then you can treat them with topical steroids. And there is a recommendation now about prophylactic treatment even for zoster. There's an RCT going on in the US, NIH-sponsored, where they're looking at even giving long-term oral acyclovir for zoster as well.
Same dose as for HSV?
For zoster, normally in the acute stage, we give 800 milligrams five times a day, so double dose. And similarly, for the prophylaxis also, it's 800 milligram BD rather than 400 milligrams.
And for how long?
1 year. But it's still a trial. It's not been proved as a standard therapy. But if you have a patient who has a known zoster and having recurrences, you could consider giving long-term 800 milligram BT.
Ma'am, and for HSV, how long is the should I be giving the oral
minimum
therapy?
Minimum one year. Sometimes you have an occasional patient who keeps having recurrences.
Yeah.
You may have to give for 2 to 3 years, but usually 1 year.
Thank you very much. I think we should conclude. Our expert panel would be exhausted. They need lunch. So thanks a lot for all of you being here. Thanks a lot, dear expert panel, each and everyone for you. In fact, I need to thank you all for being patiently with me for all my ARC webinars too. Thank you very much. I would want you all to.